Good morning. The first item of business is general questions, and at question number one I call Keith Brown.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to support bat conservation.
Cabinet Secretary Mary McCallan.
Presiding Officer, all bat species found in Scotland are European protected species, and we're committed to their protection and their conservation. Through legislation, bats receive the highest level of species protection available. We know that access to a suitable roost is vital, and that's why any action which might disturb or damage a bat roost requires a licence from Nature Scot. And another key issue facing bats is the loss of suitable habitat. So our commitment to biodiversity regeneration, for example, through the Agricultural Reform Programme, will help improve the availability of foraging and prey for bats through the enhancement of farmland habitats.
Keith Brown.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer? I've recently been contacted by a number of constituents who are employed by Nature Scot as part of a group of 27 bat workers, all of whom I understand are to be facing redundancy. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what consideration has been given to the potential impact that the redundancy of Nature Scot's 27 bat workers, with their considerable experience and expertise, may have on bat conservation in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I understand the concerns. However, I would like to clarify that I understand this is not to be the loss of 27 full-time bat workers. Although employed by Nature Scot, I understand that the work is demand-driven and that in a year their collective hours amount to around 140 days, or half of a full-time member of staff. And whilst Nature Scot are looking to maximise efficiencies, this is being done whilst addressing the needs of bats on the one hand, and indeed householders on the other. Nature Scot are engaging with workers as well as the Bat Conservation Trust to ensure support for conservation is maintained, albeit in a different form than is currently provided, and all of that in advance of the next bat season. And I can make sure that Keith Brown is kept up to date.
Question number two, Mark Ruskell.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its plans to deliver a safer speed limit of 20 miles an hour by 2025 on all appropriate roads in built-up areas.
Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hislop.
The Scottish Government is committed to implement 20 miles per hour speed limits on appropriate roads by the end of 2025. If you're hit by a car in a built-up area at 20 miles per hour, you are 7 times more likely to survive than being hit at 30 miles per hour. In the 36-month period after implementing, Edinburgh City Council have seen a 31% reduction in casualty rates on the 20 miles per hour roads. All councils have now submitted their road assessment, identifying the appropriate roads for a speed limit of 20 miles per hour. Notably, councils themselves drive this work. A delivery subgroup that consists of officials from Transport Scotland, local authorities and wider road safety partners will oversee the implementation and will produce a detailed programme for delivery to meet the 2025 deadline, containing the actual costs to complete this important road safety initiative. Highland Council are currently successfully early adopters of speed reductions, with communities who don't have 20 miles speed limits yet asking for them.
Mark Ruskell.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response and also thank her for the constructive working that we've had on this and many other issues since she came back into government last year. From the borders to the Highlands, 20 mile an hour speed limits have been welcomed by communities, reducing dangerous speeds, making places feel safer and friendlier, and ultimately, as she says, saving lives. I welcome the progress being made by every single council in Scotland to identify those 20 mile an hour plans, but can the Cabinet Secretary confirm that the funding is there for councils to deliver this as a coordinated national programme so that no community is left behind and no child in the future has to live on a residential street with a dangerous speed limit?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his comments. The Scottish Government has allocated a record £36 million for road safety to reduce casualties and risks on our roads, delivering against our priorities within the road safety framework. Local road authorities were asked to identify the number of roads which would be suitable for a speed limit of 20 miles per hour and provide the approximate costs to implement within their respective areas. Highland Council, who are early adopters, as I said, of the strategy, are currently 62% below the original estimated budget. So any speculation based on rough estimates rather than detailed plans would be premature. Once we obtain receiving detailed costs from local authorities through the delivery subgroup, we will consider what proportion of the overall road safety budget is required this financial year to deliver a coordinated programme and through towards 2025 as well.
Graeme Simpson.
Thank you. Can I just say that I hope Mark Ruskell gets better pretty soon, because he's obviously not too well at the minute. Can I just ask the Cabinet Secretary to confirm that this will be entirely a matter for local councils? There will not be the same disastrous blanket rollout of 20 mile an hour as we've seen in Wales, which has had economically disastrous consequences for that country. Has she done any economic analysis for Scotland if such an approach was to be adopted?
Cabinet Secretary.
So if the Conservative member had kept up with developments, and I understand he probably hasn't, having read some of his comments in the papers, the difference between ourselves and Wales is the Welsh Labour government introduced a blanket 20 miles per hour reduction and is then hastily introducing retrospective exemptions by council. But the Scottish Government has had upfront exemptions for councils led by them, identified with steady and agreed rollout of 20 miles per hour speed reductions. I would say, however, that there have been positive studies so far from Wales as to the impact that they've had. And in terms of economic development and business impact, I think certainly high streets have the benefit of people being able to shop and walk and enjoy their town centres at leisure. And I think that certainly is the feedback we're already receiving. But I think you maybe want to visit some of the communities in the Highlands, including Ross Markle, who campaigned for 2 decades to get that 20 miles per hour limit introduced.
Question number 3, Jamie Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it will improve connectivity on the islands of Arran and Cumbrae ahead of the busy summer tourist season.
Cabinet Secretary.
I understand that the news yesterday from CalMAC advising that the expected return date for MV Caledonia Isles is now August will be frustrating for the community. I continue to urge CalMAC to work closely with both communities to make best use of available vessels and provide as much capacity as possible throughout this period of disruption. I welcome and support the recent statements from Sheila Gilmer on Arran and from Angus Campbell of the Cumbrae Ferry Committee. Both islands remain open for business. There is passenger capacity and public transport options for both islands, and I also appreciate the patience of passengers on other routes disrupted as a consequence of this temporary vessel deployment to help support the islands he's identified.
Jamie Green.
It goes without saying that our islands are open for business, but frustration is an underestimation of the strength of feeling on our islands. What they're actually staring down the barrel of is a summer of more chaos in the ferry network. We've got the MV Lough Shearer out of action servicing Cumbrae. That's causing a lot of consternation on that island. The MV Caledonian Isles will not be around this summer, and the Glen Sannox has been delayed as well. That simply leaves the Isle of Arran, which is a 40-year-old vessel and prone to breakdown itself. Is it any wonder that our islanders are nervous about the forthcoming summer season? Maybe I can give the Cabinet Secretary an opportunity to apologise in advance of the chaos that our government is causing.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, if you listen to islanders, they will say it's not necessarily taken as read that the message is that our islands are open for business. And I think it's incumbent on all parties to reiterate that our islands are open for business. In terms of the deployment for the two islands that he mentioned, I did say in my original answer that there is capacity and that the passengers are able to travel. This is a challenge. We undoubtedly know that. But I think it is also important for us to identify there are 6 new vessels that will be delivered for 2026 that will support not just the islands he referred to, obviously Arran in particular, but also Islay, Little Minch, and that also have an impact across the period. I have been upfront saying that this will be a difficult time, particularly with dry docking, but let's get behind our islands, say they're open for business, and do that with a united voice.
A brief supplementary, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Cabinet Secretary, we know that repairs to the Cal Isles are more extensive than previously anticipated. But how can anyone have any confidence in CalMAC's repair timescales that have went from March to June and now August? And how can island businesses plan ahead with these constantly moving goalposts? I'm delighted that she's told everyone and reminded people that Arnott is open for business. But what practical steps is the government going to take to get that message over to the wider public who only see bad news on the television and hear it in the radio and read it in the newspapers?
Cabinet Secretary.
I am acutely aware of the impact that the disruptions can have for people and businesses. However, as I stated, there is capacity. There are vessels that are being deployed to support these vital areas. And the complexity of the Canary Isle vessel's design means the repairs must be carried out in a coordinated, controlled manner, which is a highly complex repair effort. I have made it clear to CalMAC that I think it would be helpful for them to be upfront and, I think, realistic about timescales, because that does help some kind of confidence in terms of planning. The island does remain open for businesses and services, and it will continue with the MV Isles of Arran and Alfred. Transport Scotland are urgently considering a request from the Arran Ferry Committee and CalMAC to increase funding to enable full passenger capacity on MV Alfred for the period the MV Caledonian Isles is out of service. And I will continue to stress to CalMAC the need to clearly communicate that that island remains open for business.
Question number 4, James Dornan.
To ask the Scottish Government what role the Housing Scotland Bill will play in achieving a more sustainable private rented sector.
Minister Paul McLennan.
The Housing Bill includes a package of rented sector reforms that provide additional rights and protections for tenants that aim to improve their experience of renting a home. A fairer, well-regulated rented sector is good for tenants and responsible landlords. The measures we have brought forward in the bill support tenants with considering the needs of landlords and will help to drive and deliver a thriving sector that delivers good quality, affordable options for those who rely on it for a home.
James Dornan.
Okay, I thank the Minister for that answer, but can the Minister maybe further outline how the policies in the Housing Bill can benefit tenants by securing them an affordable quality home and at the same time benefit landlords seeking to reinvest in their property?
Minister.
Can I thank the member for that question? A thriving and fair rented sector that allows landlords to provide good quality homes at a reasonable cost for tenants, of course, is vital for meeting Scotland's housing needs. I will be taking forward the Housing Bill, and obviously will continue to discuss that with the sector and other stakeholders going forward.
Thank you. We move to question number 5, and I call Tim Eagle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what activity it will undertake regarding its action plan to address depopulation.
Minister Paul McLennan.
Thank the member for his question. The publication of our Addressing Depopulation Action Plan represents the first phase of a strategic long-term approach to supporting communities experiencing population decline. This includes a range of new commitments aimed at supporting local leadership in responding to these challenges. We have also committed to establishing an Addressing Depopulation Delivery Group, working closely with key regional, local and community partners. This group will monitor and evaluate the delivery of the action plan and ensure that the valuable lessons and learning is captured, which can be applied more broadly across Scotland in order to deliver a sustainable solution to these challenges.
Tim Eagle.
The action plan's Addressing Depopulation Fund amounts to just £180,000 to be split over 3 local authorities over 2 years. Given the acute shortage of professionals, including doctors, nurses, carers, teachers and more, along with seeing huge amounts of young people moving away from rural areas, isn't the reality, Minister, that this fund is barely a sticking plaster to those communities suffering prolonged loss of local services and an exodus of people?
Minister.
The fund will initially make available £180,000 to be split between perspective of 3 local authorities, as you mentioned. It will be operational across financial years 24-25 and 25-26. It is intended that interventions taken forward will generate learning, which will be more broadly applicable to communities across Scotland.
Brief supplementary, Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister will be aware of Uist being classified as a repopulation zone, providing temporary accommodation and long-term help to find employment and a permanent home for people moving to the area. The Council, the public sector, private sector and communities is involved in this, but they highlight the issue of housing being the biggest issue. So can I ask what the Scottish Government are doing to provide homes to retain and to attract populations to rural and island communities?
Minister.
Thank you, Member, for the question. I recently visited Uist, I think, a number of months ago and spoke to communities not just around about housing but broader issues. that were there. We obviously announced a rural housing action plan in terms of that as well. There's obviously opportunities around about renewables, and which might bring additional homes to there. So again, we're engaging with the likes of SSEN in terms of that. I continue to engage with the local authority on that matter. I'm happy to engage with the member further on that if she wishes to do so.
Thank you. Let's keep questions and responses concise. I call Ross Greer.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what action it's taking in response to reports of potential staff redundancies at the Thermo Fisher scientific site in Paisley.
Minister Gillian Martin.
Presiding Officer, I was concerned to learn of proposed job losses at the Thermo Fisher scientific site in Inchinnan. My immediate thoughts are obviously with the employees affected by this announcement, who are undoubtedly very anxious about their jobs and their futures. I wrote to the company outlining my concerns a number of weeks ago, but I also spoke with them directly this morning to discuss the situation and how they might be redeploying staff where possible. Scottish Enterprise has been engaging with the company, and Scottish Government is on hand to provide support to those facing redundancy through our initiative for responding to redundancy situations, Partnership Action for Continuing Employment, or PACE. PACE has already engaged with the company.
Ross Greer.
I thank the Minister for the work that she's done to support Thermo Fisher staff. Workers at the site have raised concerns with me that the real reason for these potential job losses is offshoring. Thermo Fisher plan to move the jobs overseas to cut costs and maximise profits. While this Parliament has limited powers over employment, there are steps the Government can take to drive up conditions for workers. The Scottish Greens delivered a whole raft of new conditions on the money the Scottish Government spends, ensuring more Scottish workers get paid a real living wage, for example. Given that Thermo Fisher received £150 million worth of contracts from the Government in the last 5 years, will the Scottish Government apply conditions on future contracts to ensure that companies in receipt of huge sums of public money keep those jobs here in Scotland?
Minister.
I'd like to be able to update Mr Greer and the Parliament on some of the things that came out of the conversation, but I will address this point about contracts. Public contracts are awarded to companies in compliance with procurement legislation, as well as international agreements such as the World Trade Organization's Government Procurement Agreement. Contract terms and conditions are focused on the delivery of the contract and are proportionate and relevant to the contract subject matter. And procurement rules require equal treatment, transparency and proportionality in public procurement processes, precluding the exclusion of companies who conduct their businesses lawfully. But if I can just say, from my meeting this morning, I've heard that 20 employees have been redeployed within the company already, and a number of the affected employees have already found jobs out with Thermo Fisher. But for those that are remaining, all have accepted voluntary redundancy packages with the firm, but the firm has also made a commitment to prioritise them for current in-house vacancies. They've got around 65 vacancies in Inchinnan and around 30 across the UK, some of which can allow remote working. They've also contracted a training and services company to be able to train them for recruitment.
Thank you. Question number 7, Douglas Lumsden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government, regarding its plans to achieve net zero by 2045, what its response is to the Electricity System Operators Report beyond 2030?
Minister Gillian Martin.
The Electricity System Operators Beyond 2030 report recommends the need for significant upgrades to electricity networks across GB, bringing forward billions of pounds of investment in networks in Scotland. Expansion of the electricity grid is crucial in enabling us to deliver energy security, reduce our greenhouse gas emissions, reduce domestic fuel costs and maximise the economic opportunities of Scotland's abundant renewable resources. It's absolutely imperative that communities have the opportunity to engage in the process at an early stage, and developers must take every opportunity to work with those communities well ahead of submitting any applications for consent.
Douglas Lumsden.
I think we all accept that the grid needs upgrading, but we cannot allow the desecration of the north-east of Scotland in achieving this. Many of my constituents in Turriff and Newdia are alarmed at the scale of industrialisation on their doorstep. So can the Minister confirm that the devolved government will use planning powers in their hands to stop the overdevelopment of these areas?
Minister. Mr Lumsden mentions Turriff and Newdia, also my constituents as well, and obviously I want to engage with them as much as possible to ensure that they have the opportunity to engage with the TSOs and the electricity system operator about developments in their area so their voices are heard. Scottish Government, Scottish Ministers have no power to instruct transmission owners to opt for any undergrounding cables, for example, or indeed have any influence over the applications that they submit. That is up to them. It is incumbent on them to engage with those communities and bring them with them as they put their submissions forward.